Good morning all. Hope you are doing good in this COVID era. Today's our topic is proptosis and orbital tumors. Right? Now we are going to see this topics today. That is the what is actually proptosis, what are the causes, how to approach a patient with proptosis, causes, different causes mainly in adults, and we are going to see different orbital tumors and take home message. Okay, now what is proptosis? Proptosis is forward displacement or bulging of eyeball. Now there is other terminology, that is exophthalmos. Okay, so exophthalmos is abnormal protrusion of eyeball mainly due to endocrinal dysfunction, and basically it is related to thyroid. So proptosis is in general term and exophthalmos is due to thyroid abnormality. Now what are the causes? Causes are divided into congenital and acquired causes. In congenital, there might be dermoid cysts, teratoma or congenital cystic eyeball. In acquired causes, they are more common. They include inflammatory, infectious, traumatic, vascular, cystic and neoplastic causes. What are in the inflammatory? That is also a common causes of proptosis. That is thyroid related orbitopathy, idiopathic orbital inflammatory disease, that is pseudotumor. There infectious like histiocytosis. There is also a sarcoidosis, Wegener's granulomatosis and amyloidosis. What is there in infectious etiology? That is orbital cellulitis. If it involves the structure behind the orbital septum. It is subperiosteal abscess if there is abscess formation in the orbital spaces. Traumatic causes, that is blowout fracture, retrobulbar hemorrhage, carotid cavernous fistula. Vascular causes, that is orbital varices and various aneurysm of ophthalmic artery. Cysts, they are hydrated cyst. Sinus related, that is mucosal and various tumors. In neoplastic causes, that is capillary cavernous hemangioma, rhabdomyosarcoma, lacrimal gland tumors, optic nerve sheath glioma and meningioma, retinoblastoma, neurofibroma, leukemia, lymphoma. Okay, so this is all related to causes. Now how to approach a patient with proptosis? We have to go through history, his examination and various investigation. Now what is there in history part? Now we have to ask the age. We have to see the age. There are many causes which are common in pediatric age group, various in adult. Okay, nature, that is sudden and gradual. Sudden is mainly due to related to trauma. Gradual, that is neoplastic in origin. Duration, that is continuous. Is it continuously progressive or it is acute, as I said before, that is due to trauma. Intermittent or postural or Valsalva, that is mainly seen in orbital varices and aneurysm. Pulsatile proptosis is seen in carotid cavernous fistula. We have to ask for associated symptoms like vision loss if it is involving optic nerve, if it is chronic proptosis and related to exposure keratopathy, then it is associated with vision loss. Pain when there is orbital inflammatory disorders like pseudotumor, when there is inflammatory causes, that is pain. Okay, diplopia when it is involving extraocular muscles, like in thyroid associated orbitopathy. We have to ask past history related to thyroid disorder, if patient is known case of hyper or hypothyroidism. Malignancy, if it is elsewhere inside the body, if there is metastasis inside orbit due to primary malignancy. Now, what is there in examination part? We have to look, there is local examination, that is inspection, palpation, auscultation and various tests, which will help to localize or to approach our diagnosis. Okay, and systemic evaluation. Now how to do local examination? So first we have to inspect. Okay, so what we are going to look for, that is it a true proptosis or pseudoproptosis? Now what is pseudoproptosis? That is the simulation of bulging of eyeball. It is not actually there, but it is a simulation because of various causes, like if patient is having high myopia, that is the eyeball is itself enlarged because of high myopia, but there is no protrusion of eyeball. When there is contralateral enophthalmos, of contralateral eye is enophthalmos, that is it is retroplaced, then there is a simulation of proptosis of normally placed eyeball. okay, when there is ptosis of contralateral eye or retraction of similar eye, there is a pseudoproptosis. So we have to first localize, that is, it is a true proptosis or pseudoproptosis. Now we have to look, it is unilateral or bilateral. Some causes are unilateral, that is, if it is dermoid cyst, if it is related to trauma, traumatic blowout fracture, if it is related to cellulitis or abscess or cavernous sinus thrombosis, thyroid eye disorder, it can be unilateral or bilateral. Okay, then there is orbital varices. Now there are causes of bilateral proptosis. Bilateral, when there is a bony malformation like craniofacial synostosis or osteitis deformans or rickets, can lead to bilateral. Okay, then leukemia, lymphoma, it can be bilateral proptosis. Now we have to see for, that is, if it is axial proptosis or abaxial proptosis. Axial, that means it is inside the swelling is inside the intraconal compartment. When it is arising from the optic nerve, that will lead to forward straight line bulging of eyeball. That is axial proptosis. Like a optic nerve sheath glioma, meningioma, like neurofibroma, that is all hydrated cysts, they are all causes of axial proptosis. Now what is abaxial or non-axial proptosis? When there is lateral displacement of eyeball, when the tumor arising from the medial part of the eyeball, like in the lacrimal sac tumor, okay, then it is led to lateral displacement of eyeball. When there is infronasal displacement, when there is tumor arising from the lacrimal gland, okay, when there is superior displacement of eyeball, when there is the tumor arising from the maxillary sinus, there is pressure effect. So the eyeball is displaced superior. Okay, so they are the causes of non-axial, abaxial proptosis. So we have to look for true or pseudo, we have to look for lateral or bilateral, if it is axial or abaxial. Also we have to look for lead signs. It is helpful in thyroid. Okay, when there is lid leg or lid retraction, if there is S-shaped deformity of upper eyelid in case of plexiform neurofibroma, lid leg and lid retraction in case of thyroid associated orbitopathy. Okay, now this we have covered inspection part. Now what is there in palpation? We have to proptosis is like, if there is a swelling, we have to look for its size, shape, okay, margin, surrounding surface, okay, then orbital ream. Normally we can palpate orbital ream or around the eyeball, but if the tumor or the swelling arising from the anterior part, then we cannot deliberate or we cannot identify the margins of orbits. Okay, now we have to also palpate regional lymph nodes. Okay, now what is auscultation? Now auscultation, it is helpful in Bruy. Okay, so when there is orbital varices or carotid cavernous fistula, that is a fistula or connection between the carotid artery and the cavernous sinus, there is high arterial flow. Okay, so that will give rise to Bruy, that we can hear the high arterial flow with the help of stethoscope. Okay, in the when we place our stethoscope onto the eyeball. Now what are the other tests we have to do? That is transillumination, that is helpful in case of cyst. Okay, and then visual acuity. As I said before, vision is decreased when there is pressure effect of swelling over the eyeball, that is astigmatism, or if the swelling arising from the optic nerve, like optic nerve sheath glioma or meningioma. When there is chronic swelling like thyroid associated orbitopathy, there is exposure keratopathy or exposure keratitis, vision is decreased. Pupillary reaction, what is normally when there is optic nerve involvement because of either pressure effect or the swelling arises directly from the optic nerve, there is RAPD, that is relative afferent pathway defect. That is pupillary reaction we have to look for when there is, especially we have to look for RAPD. Ocular motility. What is there in ocular motility? When there is thyroid associated orbitopathy, there is glycosaminoglycans accumulation inside the extraocular muscles. So that's why there is restriction of motility. Post reduction tests similarly helpful in thyroid associated orbitopathy when there is continuous glycosaminoglycans accumulation, then there is chronicity of the that is accumulation leads to fibrosis of muscles. Tonometry, that is helpful especially in case of that is thyroid associated orbitopathy, that is differentiated tonometry. When we measure tonometry IOP in straight gaze, and if we examine IOP in up gaze, that is if difference of more than 5 mm of mercury of IOP, then there is a significant extraocular muscle involvement and it is bracing over the outflow, venous outflow of the eyeball. Okay, so there is differential tonometry that is helpful in thyroid associated orbitopathy. Fundoscopy, if we have to look for various like papilloedema or retinal hemorrhages or choroidal folds when the swelling is pressing behind the eyeball. Exophthalmometry, that is a measurement of that protrusion. There are various method of exophthalmometry that we measure the how much amount of eyeball is protrudes. That is, if the normal amount is, if it is more than 21 millimeter, then we measure the distance from lateral orbital margin to the corneal apex. If it is more than 21 millimeter or there is difference of more than 2 millimeter between two eyes, it is significant. Okay, so there are various methods. We can simply measure it by the ruler, or there is Hertel's exophthalmometer that it can measure bilateral simultaneously. Okay. Now, what is the systemic evaluation? General physical examination for systemic diseases. Thyroid evaluation, thyroid function test. We have to look for primary neoplasm elsewhere, okay, like breast, lung, okay, and ENT examination if there is sinus is involved or not. Okay, laboratory investigation just to confirm that complete blood count, differential count, thyroid function test, Caissonis test that we hardly do, but there is a helpful in hydatid cyst, urine analysis for multiple myeloma, Benz-Jones protein, also stool test for identifying ovine cyst in case of parasites like cysticercosis. That radiological examination, that is very helpful. Especially we are doing simple, that is X-rays to see in case of blowout fractures. Also, CT scan, USG, MRI, these are all helpful for identification, the location of the swelling. Carotid angiography is helpful in carotidocavernous fistula. Now, what are the causes in adults? Most common causes are thyroid, exophthalmos, also pseudotumor, orbital cellulitis, trauma, meningioma, optic nerve sheath meningioma, lymphoma, cavernous hemangioma, or tumors extending from the other areas and metastasis. And these are all various description of various causes. I will go further later. Now, this is all related to proptosis. Okay, so what is the definition of proptosis? What are the causes? How to evaluate, like inspection, palpation, auscultation? What are the common causes in adults? How to approach it? Now, we are going to see various orbital tumors, common orbital tumors. The first thing arises when there is orbital proptosis is thyrotoxicosis. Okay, so what is thyrotoxicosis? It is an autoimmune disorder. Okay, mainly thyroid related disorder most common in females. So females are more affected, 8 times more affected than males. So mainly it is third or fourth decade. Okay, mainly that is inflammation of extraocular muscle. Extraocular muscle is thickened, sparing the tendon. Okay, mainly Bailey is involved. That is glycosaminoglycans infiltration of extraocular muscle. Okay, now clinical manifestation is proptosis, lid retraction, optic neuropathy because of chronicity, and ultimately because of that glycosaminoglycans and water imbibition of that extraocular muscles, in long term it will lead to fibrosis and there is restrictive myopathy. Now, characteristic of proptosis in thyroid eye disease, it is axial proptosis. Okay, it can be unilateral or bilateral. Because of chronicity, it will lead to various complications like exposure keratopathy, corneal ulceration, infection, and compression optic neuropathy. That compression optic neuropathy we have to look for, as I said before, that is, we have to check for pupillary reaction, vision, color vision. Okay, so this is a picture of thyroid associated orbitopathy. That is, you can see lid retraction in both eyes. Right eye is more proptosed than left eye. Okay, then there is inflammatory swelling. Okay, that is more congested eyeball. Now what we have to investigate? We have to investigate his or her thyroid profile. Smoking, we have to ask, we have to advise that we have to stop that smoking. Okay, it will lead to further damage to optic nerve. Examination, CT scan, visual fields because of that optic nerve. Okay, what is the now treatment of this thyrotoxicosis? If it is mild proptosis, I've shown in figure, just we have to give him or lubricating eye drops, eyelid tapping at night, and cold compression. When there is orbital restrictive myopathy or compressive optic neuropathy, we have to give oral prednisolone or 60 to 80 milligram per day, tapered over 2 to 8 weeks. And when there is compressive optic neuropathy, we have to give him pulse therapy of IV intravenous methyl prednisolone. Okay, to reduce that inflammatory, autoimmune inflammatory disorder it is. So to combat that inflammation, we have to inject IV pulse therapy. Radiotherapy if there is compressive optic neuropathy. Okay. And surgical decompression if it is markedly compression of optic nerve. Okay. So this is all related to thyroid associated orbitopathy. Now what is pseudotumor? Pseudotumor is also a common entity after that thyroid associated orbitopathy. Now, it is also orbital inflammatory disease, but it is idiopathic in origin. Similar to thyroid, it is an inflammatory disorder, but here the cause is not identified. It is non-infectious, non-neoplastic, may involve any soft tissue of orbit. Okay, muscle, lacrimal gland, tenon capsule and sclera. Presentation usually unilateral in adults, but in children, the characteristic of pseudotumor, it is bilateral. Okay, it can be bilateral in children. Mainly it involves in the third to sixth decade. Now, the patient is giving history of acute painful proptosis. Okay. Ophthalmoplegia, that is restricted eye motility, optic nerve dysfunction, and there is palpable mass because of enlarged extraocular muscle. Now, can you see that similar to that thyroid-associated orbitopathy? That is, here the inflammatory response is very severe. Okay, so that is, the right eye is affected more. Okay, so that is more inflamed, eyeball proptosis. But how we differentiate between this thyroid and this pseudotumor? So by workup. So we have to ask for history that if it is associated with thyroid dysfunction or not. Examination similar to we have to inspect, palpate, and we have to go for that blood investigation. Okay, so here the differentiating point is that it involves whole muscle in a toto, not sparing tendon as I said in thyroid associated ophthalmopathy. In thyroid, the enlargement of muscle is restricted to belly only, but in pseudotumor, it involves whole muscle, not sparing tendon. Okay, so pseudotumor is like tumor, it can involve anywhere. Okay, so if it is persistent, then we also go for FNS, the aspiration cytology. Usually, there is a spontaneous remission, okay, but there is intermittent episodes. If there is prolonged inflammation, it can lead to fibrosis of extraocular muscle and it will lead to frozen orbit, that is ophthalmoplegia, and ultimately visual impairment. Now, what is treatment? Treatment is mainly steroids. Because of it is idiopathic inflammatory disorders, When there is mild inflammation, there we can give oral non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. But if it is inflammation is very severe, we can give him or her to systemic steroids. And if it is not controlled, we can give here also. If there is no response to steroids, we can give radiotherapy also. If patient is contraindicated to steroids, we can give anti-metabolites like methotrexate or mycophenolate mofetil. Systemic infliximab also, that is a anti-interferon therapy. Now, this is all related to thyroid and pseudotumor. These two are more common. Now, what is the we are going rapidly various other tumors or other causes of proptosis. Now, what is cavernous hemangioma? That is the MCQ is most frequently asked. That is most common intraorbital tumor of adults. You have to remember that cavernous hemangioma is most common intraorbital tumor of adult. It is a tumor. Mainly, it is affecting 3rd to 5th decade unilateral. Okay, female, it is reported, but does not many female is affected more than males. That is benign, what is pathophysiology? Benign slow growing vascular lesion, okay, that is causing proptosis. Can you see that picture? That is a cavernous hemangioma. Okay. So, what is the presentation? That is middle-aged females mostly, axial proptosis. Okay. So, because of it is axial, causing the axial proptosis or swelling inside the intraconal compartment, it is giving pressure to the optic nerve. So, there is decrease in visual acuity, sometimes diplopia. Okay. The signs are, that is the dilated tortuous epibulbar vessels because of there is vascular lesion tumor. Okay, fundus is optic disc edema and choroid folds because location is in the intraconal compartment. Okay, CT and USG are helpful. Okay, so the surgical, that the treatment modality is always surgical, but in surgical treatment that we have to look for, that is a vascular benign tumor. So we have to keep the blood, we have to take help of blood bank also. We have to remove and block. Okay, so you can see in, with this picture that we have to remove it is in block. Okay, so various approaches like orbitotomy, that is opening inside the orbit. So if it is lateral lesion, lateral orbitotomy, if it is some medially located, then upper eyelid or transcarynchal base medial orbitotomy. Okay, now the other common is CCF. So these are various short notes also that you can be asked in your examination. What is CCF? That is carotidocavernous fistula. That is abnormal communication between cavernous sinus and external or internal carotid arteries. The classification based on etiology like chromatic or spontaneous, high versus low velocity CCF, or anatomy like direct or indirect CCF. CCF, that means carotidocavernous fistula. Okay, so there is abnormal communication between, that is, you can see that that ICA, that is internal carotid artery, and the blue, that is cavernous sinus. There is abnormal communication. Okay, what is direct? The direct is more common, 70 to 90% of all cases, and there is abnormal communication between intracavernous part of ICA and cavernous sinus. Okay, so direct internal carotid artery flow, that is high velocity flow, is going inside the cavernous sinus. Okay, so that is high arterial blood flow. Okay, the causes are spontaneous, 25% of cases, but mainly the trauma. Trauma is the 75% of direct CCF is due to trauma. Okay, or may sometimes iatrogenic. What is indirect? Indirect, that is not direct inside the cavernous sinus, but some of branches of ICA, that is meningeal branch of ICA and cavernous sinus. Okay, that is communication between the meningeal branches of ICA or ECA, that is external carotid artery, to cavernous sinus. Because of some branches involved, there is low arterial blood flow. Okay, the main causes is spontaneous or congenital. Now, what is the presentation? You have to remember triad of this CCF, that is proptosis, chemosis and that is noise, oozing noise inside the head because of high arterial blood flow. Okay. So can you see that inside this picture there is markedly dilated conjunctival vessels. Okay. So, and there is noise inside the head. Patient is telling you that I can hear something is going inside my head. So, pulsatile proptosis because of heavy arterial blood flow, chemosis and noise inside head. Epibulbar injection as I shown in that picture. Increased IOP because of there is positive pressure inside the venous return. Okay. Anterior segment ischemia, if there is no venous return, there is a hampering of blood supply inside the ocular structure. Okay. So, what are the signs of anterior segment ischemia? That is corneal edema, aqueous flare, iris atrophy, rubeosus iridis, that is neovascular formation over the iris, and ultimately complicated cataract. So, we can hear that bruit by placing the stethoscope over upper eyelid. So, this is a clinical picture of CCF. Ultimately, what it will lead to? Exposure keratopathy, ophthalmoplegia, and fundus changes, like you can see hemorrhages, venous tortuosity, okay, optic disc swelling, ultimately CRVO, that is central retinal vein occlusion, and neovascular glaucoma. Okay, so CT scan and MRI, specifically MRI and MRI angiography, that is helpful in diagnosis. We can see the enlargement of, what are the findings? That is enlargement of extraocular muscles, dilation of one or both superior ophthalmic veins, and enlargement of affected cavernous sinus. We can see the communication with the help of the MRI angiography. Now, treatment is mainly surgical. Okay, that when there is failure to spontaneous closure, we have to do surgical repair of damaged portion, electrothrombolyze or embolize or balloon occlusion of that fistula. Okay, so that is all related to CCF. Now, what is some part is remaining, that is optic nerve sheath meningioma and optic nerve sheath glioma. You can be asked this also, okay, what is the optic nerve sheath tumors? Okay, so there are optic nerve sheath meningioma and glioma. So, what is optic nerve sheath meningioma? That is the tumor arising from the meningoepithelial cells of the dura mater, the coverings of that optic nerve. There is primary optic nerve sheath meningioma and secondary. What is primary? That when the tumor is directly arising from the intraorbital or intracanalicular portion of optic nerve. Okay, so directly arising from the optic nerve. And what is secondary? That is extension of intracranial meningioma into the orbit. Okay, so primary and secondary. Okay, so secondary optic nerve sheath meningioma is more common than primary. Now, what is the presentation? Meningioma, it is late onset, and glioma, it is early onset. So, mainly the meningioma is in the 6 to 8 decade. Female is more than males. Female is more commonly affected than males. Because of it is involving optic nerve, there is chronic painless progressive visual impairment. Okay, there is axial proptosis, most commonly unilateral. It is associated with headache. Okay, so if the female around the age of 60s or 50s, and if she is complaining of headache and proptosis, and if she is giving history that it is progressing slowly, then we have to go for the that we have to keep in mind the optic nerve sheath meningioma. Okay, what is the classical triad here also? That is visual loss, optic atrophy, and optociliary shunt vessels. Okay, 30% of cases we can see optociliary shunt vessels. So, can you see in this imaging technique? That is the axial proptosis, that is the tumor involving the posterior to the eyeball. Okay. So, in the picture, in the lower side, you can see the optociliary shunt vessels. Now, what is the treatment? Mostly observation if there is no intracranial extension or no vision loss, if it is the primary optic nerve sheath meningioma. But if it is secondary and if it is compressing optic nerve, there is visual field compromise and optic nerve sheath, optic nerve compression, then we have to go for radiotherapy. Primary radiation is the treatment. But if it is unresectable or recurrent, so we have to give chemotherapy and later on surgical therapy, surgical excision. Okay. Now similar is glioma. Glioma most commonly it is in childhood. Adult is it is very rare. Okay, so it is astrocytes, the astrocytoma of the optic nerve. See, mainly it is the children which are affected. Okay, so you have to just remember that meningioma is most commonly around the adults and glioma it is mainly in the children. Okay, so we are going to finish. That is our lecture. That is what is proptosis. You have seen various causes, how to approach and how to investigate each and every patient and various causes, most common causes of proptosis like thyroid, pseudotumor, cavernous hemangioma, optic nerve sheath tumors. Okay, so according to history, how to approach that? If patient is of proptosis and there is orbital inflammation, sudden onset, prominent red eye, pain and diplopia, that we have to suspect orbital pseudotumor. Okay. But if there is history of trauma with chemosis, with pulsatile proptosis, so there is carotid cavernous fistula. Okay. So history is very important. If proptosis unilateral or bilateral, associated with lead signs, associated with thyroid signs, others. If it is, woman is there in thyroid bruit and enlargement of eyeball, proptosis, that is thyroid eye disease. Now the history is, if there is middle-aged woman, slow growing axial proptosis, then there is cavernous hemangioma. If there is rapid onset proptosis, motility problems, pain, diplopia and primary tumor we can identify, then there is metastasis. Okay, so this type of history we can approach to the patient of proptosis. So go and read the proptosis. Thank you.